Thank you for joining us today. I'm Meenakshi, Leader Marketing Strategy in Lipton and your host for the session. In today's webinar, we will do a walkthrough of our product Network Access for all of you. Introducing our speakers for the webinar today, we have Harshit Singhal, who is Leader Pre-Sales and Solutioning with us, and Sudeep Bhaumik, who is Manager Solutions and Engineering.
Hi, everyone. Good day.
Please note this is a one-hour webinar with 45 minutes demo session and 15 minutes Q&A session. So please feel free to drop in your queries in the Q&A box and our team will take this up post-demo. Over to you, Harshit and Sudeep.
Thank you, Meenakshi. Hi, everyone. So I'll just present my screen and let me know if my screen is visible to everyone. I hope so you're able to see my screen.
Yes, Sudeep, it's visible.
Okay, all right. So good day, everyone. Welcome to the webinar. So today, I hope all are fit and fine and are in the best of your health. And today we will be speaking about Network Access, which is a fiber management geosuite. Of course, the speakers, myself, Sudeep Bhaumik, as well as Harshit, who would be taking us through the demo. And now coming to the actual agendas. So fine. So just few words about Lipton. So like Lipton is actually a leader in location analytics, map data, geo consultancy services, and then works in multiple domains, from which telecom is one of the major one. We are also the biggest partner for Google Maps. Now that was about Lipton. And now coming up to the tool or the software that we are speaking today, that is on Network Access. So now Network Access is actually a fiber lifecycle management geosuite, which helps to plan, design, inventory, and operationalize all the requirements that is basically used for a telecom company that may be an ISP, an FTTX company, wherever it is, so we can use over there. And now coming to the major blocks inside Network Access. So like Network Access has its individual blocks, which works independently, but also they are interconnected to each other. And to start with, the bedrock of the system, that is smart inventory. So now smart inventory. Now this is the tool which on which we will be having the demo today, and we'll go into much details of it. And I'll just speak few lines about smart inventory as well as the other modules also. So in smart inventory, it is actually the tool on which the entire inventory resides. So here a true digital replica of your network can be created. It is again a single interface, like, you know, it is a web-based interface through which different users can see the entire network together. And now we can forget about things in the past, like the network is placed into bits and pieces in somebody's system, in somebody's laptop, in somebody's mobile or something. So now everything gets integrated into a single unified web-based page. And people can keep on editing, can add things, and it can be equally reflected on the tool. This also shows the end-to-end network. So here you can model each and every element that is present. That may be your FTTX network, that may be a core network in which you can have fibers, you can have trenches, you can have ducts, the manholes, the splice closures, each and everything, as well as the active elements, that is the routers, the switches, all the other active elements like MUX, DMUX, and all these all can be built up on the system, and they can be actually shown up in a single interface. The granularity of the system is we can reach till the connection levels, that is the splicing levels, the core levels of it, the customer connectivity to it. So we can get into the lowest granularity as well as show the highest parts also together of the core network. So now that was about smart inventory. Now coming to the next block. So that's called smart planner. Now this planner is actually the tool in which you can do the planning of any FTTH network. So like with some minimum kind of inputs, like where the home passes are present, where are your customer hotspots, where is the location where you want to create the network, and also taking up some configuration related things, like what is the splice closure, number of ports that you are looking for, what is the branching cable specifications you want to put in. So all these kind of small inputs are taken from the system, from the user, and now the work and the rest of the work is done by the system itself, in which it does the optimized planning. Now, while the planning happens, it takes care of many small things like what is the shortest path, whether there is enough amount of cores present on that, where should be the primary splitter be located, where should be the secondary splitter located. So all these things can be actually planned and created by this tool itself. So like with some minimum inputs, you get this entire plan in your hand. And now this plan consists of the BOM, the BOQ, the cost of what the rollout would be, and also what are the materials that would be used. So these all things together comes up with a very nice result through which you can actually estimate the cost of that particular rollout in that particular cluster. So now this is about the smart planner. Now coming to the next one, so that's called smart ops, smart operations. Now this tool not only inventorizes, not only plans, but also have the option to handle your operations. So like suppose there, this smart ops comes with a mobile app also. So like this field engineers will have the mobile app in their hand, and that's our eyes through which we can find out where their current position is through their GPS location. And basis that we can actually trigger a lot of, tickets and services that can be sent out from the mobile app itself. We will be also demoing the mobile app together. Mobile app, just a minute. We will be also triggering we will be showing the mobile app also. Now coming to the next one, so that's the smart SQ. Now smart SQ is actually the service qualification tool. So in this we can actually find out, like suppose there is an enterprise customer, and just with this minimum input of where the customer lat longs are present, we can find out where their position is, and basis that we can find out which is the nearest element or the nearest network access point from this customer. And again, we can come out with what is the shortest path to connect it, what are the elements that are required to connect it, as well as what is the cost for connecting them. So this is about smart SQ. Now coming to the last one, that is on Neo 360. Now this is actually our analytics platform on which we can conduct a host of analysis on the different KPIs that we get from the wireline tool, from the wireless tool, and as well as through that we can find out that these KPIs are good or bad in a particular geography. So like just for example, where are major call drops happening, where are major fiber cuts happening, where are the major SLAs being dropped because of some different issues. So all these things can be actually plotted on the map, and we can show the red zones, the green zones, the black zones through the map itself. That can give you a good GIS kind of visualization with the KPIs inside it. So these are all the blocks of network access. Now, again, as I would repeat, like smart inventory is the tool on which we would be conducting the demo today. Coming to the agenda of it. Now, what is the today's demo agenda? So the first thing is we would be showing you how the network gets created, how the long distance fiber, how the inside plant elements can be created, how the wireless networks get created, even how the FTTX network related aspects are created on the system, as well as the civil infrastructure of it. The second one is like how we can plan and optimize. So like if we have the minimum input of where the point A is there, where the point B is there, so how the shortest path can be found out through it, and how the elements, like the in-between elements that may be poles, that may be splice closures, the chambers, how they can be placed optimally, as well as what would be the cost of all those entire things. So that's what we would be observing in the plan and optimize section. The next one is on the capture and build progress. So like as we have seen the network, now we have even created a shortest path on which the fiber has to be done. Now we can create a work order, or we can create a ticket of it, and we can send it out to the users. And once the users or the field engineers have it in place, then they can switch, see it on the mobile. They can track the progress that today around 50 meters of work is done, today about 70 meters of trenching is done, or something like that. So these kind of updates can be done, and that can be reviewed and can be seen on the dashboard. Coming to the last one, that's on the optimized operations. So like we can also find like if this tool is interfaced with a fiber monitoring system or with any alarm monitoring system, so we can get the alarms, and basis that we can also find the exact location of where the fiber cut has happened, because we have all the details of where, how the fiber is going through, what are the core related details and everything. So we can pinpoint the exact location of where the problem is. And on top of it, we can also add like the ticket creations can be done. We can send it out to a particular user, and from there we can track the progress of each and every tickets. And again, we can create reports out of it. So ultimately, to start with, we would have the network being created on the web, then we will be switching over to the mobile app, then again coming back to the web to show the changes and things like that. So that's it from my side. I would ask Harshit to get in, and he can just directly start presenting the tool itself. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Sudeep, for the wonderful presentation. Allow me to share my screen. Yeah. I think my screen is visible to everybody. Is it visible?
Yes, Harshit.
Yeah.
I am able to see it.
Yeah, this is the homepage of our application. As Sudeep told, that this is a left-hand smart inventory application where the users can plan, can design, can inventorize their complete telecom network. So this is the application that will be going to be used and that can manage your complete end-to-end telecom network inventory and plan their customers or the networks into that. So as you can see, that this application is a web-based application. The user can access this application from any web browser. They can type in the URL. And just by entering the authentic username and password, the users can log in into the application. So the complete suite of this network access is a GIS-based module. You can see that on the base, this is a pre-integrated with a Google map, having the Google search engine features available. Like we can search for any location, any place. The user just need to type in an address of any locality or let long of any place. And by that, they can land up to that particular location. Like this. The arrow pointing towards it is pointing towards the location that the user wants to search. You can see in the bottom, in the left bottom corner, the coordinates. So this is a GIS-based system. So you can see the coordinates of the lat-longs of the images of the locations are being updated, and it captures the lat-long where I'm hovering my cursor. Let me quickly open up a dummy network so that you can have a better idea that how the network looks like or can be mapped onto this system. So this is my layer manager section. In this layer manager section, we have all the network entities, the elements that are required to be part of network. Be it cables, be it wireline entities like cables, duct, trenches. We have the wireless entities as well, like antenna, sector, microwave link. And apart from this wireline entities that are required for the backbone network, we can manage the FTTX network too, like splitters, the customers, the FDGs, ODS, so everything can be mapped and can be managed through this application. You can see onto the map, there is some network that is being shown. So this is a dummy networking. You can see that there's some wireline part of it, some wireless part of it, and there's some FTTX part of it where some customers are also being installed. So basically, this is my POP location. POP is the location where I say that it is a point of presence. At this location, by using this information tool, if I just click over it, then I'll get to know that what are the elements that are located at this location. Like at this location, we do have a building, we do have multiple cables that are running, and you can see on the map that they are easily distinguishable by the hovering feature, like they are moving onto the map. If I want to know the information of a particular cable, then I can click onto a cable, then I can see that whatsoever are the attributes that are associated with this entity, like what is the cable name, what is the cable type. If I want to know the detailed information, then I can click on detailed form, then where I can see it's all the information related to GIS, information related to its region and province, the unique IDs, what is the cable category that we can manage, what is the cable type, so that we can select, because cable can be of multiple types, like underground cable, overhead cable, or wall clamp cable. Similarly, we can map the specification of the cables as well, like cable can run into multiple cores. So those specifications can be selected or can be mapped onto this system. On top of that, as you know, that cables run in multiple cores, so core level information of each and every cables can be seen. You can see that this cable runs onto 48 cores. So information related to tube color, tube number, core color, core number, so everything can be managed and can be mapped onto the system. Apart from this, their connectivity status can also be mapped and managed. And if there is any link or a circuit that is running onto a specific core, so those IDs, those circuit details can also be mapped onto this particular core of this cable. Apart from these attributes, there are lots of attributes that can be mapped with every entity. Like we can map the loop details, we can map the AT related details, the maintenance service details. So there are lots of attributes information that we can associate with any entity that is going to be created or mapped, managed onto this system. If you just see by the labels only, we can easily distinguish that what sort of cable it is. It is a backbone network route. Here, if I just click, then I'll get to know that what are the details of the duct or trenches that are there. Suppose I just click on a trench, then I get to know all the attributes related to trench, like what is the trench ID, what is the A location, B location, like these are the IDs of the manholes, what is the length of the trench. So the length details or the region and province details are automatically fetched onto the system because this is a GIS-based system. We can also manage the trench width, trench height, if we want to manage this information, so that can also be done. Apart from this, there are lots of attributes that can be managed into this system. If I talk about the POP location, so you know, we know that POP is a location where my equipments are installed, where my active equipments or passive equipments for both are installed. So POP location must be having certain room views so that I can install my rack, I can install my equipments inside that rack. For that, we provide this feature available, where with this system comes up with the equipment builder module, which can extensively model all the network equipments that are there in the ecosystem. Because every equipment that is there is a group of cards, slot chases, or ports. So all the things can be modeled with respect to these use cases. Here you can see that this is a room view of a particular POP, where there is a rack that is being installed. If I want to know that what are the details of this rack, I can simply look onto its rack view. Then I can able to see the equipments that are being installed over here. If I just go over onto a particular equipment, then I get to know that this is a switch that is there. In the switch, there are ports, like what are the name of the ports, how, what are the details of port IDs, so that we can see. And you can easily see that what is the connectivity status. As you can see onto the map, like these ports are blinking in with green color. That means they are connected. If I want to see the connectivity detail, I get to know that this port number 03 is being connected with the port number 03 of FMS01. If I want to see the connectivity onto the map, I can simply click on it, and that's how the connectivity can be seen. Like this is how they can be connected. Obviously, if I want to make new connections, I can open up the connection builder where I can choose multiple racks, because in a room there can be multiple racks, there can be multiple equipment. So those details I just need to choose from this UI, and then I can make the connections from other ports. Like on the AN side, you can see the ports details of the FMS. At the BN side, the port details of the switches are shown. And like this, we can manage these connections. So that's about this ISP, and where we can model all the necessary equipment that are there. Like this, we can model any equipment. Like you can see, this will build up an extensive library where I can model all the equipment types. And this is a single time process where the administrator can manage these equipment so that they can be used by the rest of the users. If I go back to the OSP part, then I can see that suppose this network is being created. So how to connect the cables, or how these cables can be connected. So first of all, we have this extensive any library. By using this any library, we have all the entities that are required to be created onto this system. Like we do have cables, we do have ducts, trenches. So every entity is present that will be used to manage the complete network. If I just look to a cable, then this cable comes up with a template-based design. Before creating any entity, the user just needs to set the template. Like he just needs to choose that what is the cable type. Cable can be of underground, overhead, or wall clamp type. So you just need to choose what are the cable categories. So there can be multiple cable categories. So cables can be choose from this category. What is the subcategory? What is the specification of the cable? So there are a lot of attributes that can be managed with respect to this entity. The users can manage the tube details. Suppose there are two tubes having 8 ports each. So those specifications can be updated. And suppose the user want to pull out this cable and draw it onto the map, he can directly just draw it like this and can hit on create. So with the same specifications, the cables can be created. Once the cables are created, then the users can also create the civil infrastructure, the manholes, ducts, trenches, anything can be created onto this system. If I come to the splicing, that how these cables should be connected. So we for that we do have the manual splicing icon. Like I can choose a junction point like this, where I can choose the equipment that needs to be spliced. Like this is joint closure ID. I'll choose the cable ID. At the both side, you can see onto the map that these are being shown, and I can hit on splice. It will open up the splice closure view where user easily can have an estimation that this is the cable ID at A end, cable ID at D end that is going to be connected via joint closure having ID 51. So likewise, you can see at the A end side, this cable is running onto multiple cores. You can see the 48 cores are there on the both cable that are there. If I want to splice them automatically, suppose I want to splice 10 to 20 cores in an automatic fashion, I can pass on the range and hit on splice. So once I will hit on, it will automatically splice the 10 to 20 cores. So that's how in the automation manner, this is splicing got work. Also, you can see the color-coded legends by which we can easily have an estimation that whatsoever ports are connected or whatsoever ports are vacant or reserved or faulty. So these status can be updated automatically onto the system. So that's about the backbone network. Now I come to the wireless network. So for the wireless network, you can see that the system can manage these microwave links. It can manage the sites, towers, details, all the things can be mapped. If I just click on a location, then I'll get to know that what are the entities associated with the wireless network that are there. Like we do have a building. In the building, we have the, we can have the towers, we can have the sectors. So those informations can be seen. Like if I hit a tower detail, then I can able to see all the attributes that are related to this tower. Like what is ID, what is the tower name, what can be the tower height, when this tower has been created. So all the details with respect to creation or modification of any entity can be managed. In the similar way, if the user want to see the details of the microwave link that is being managed, the user just need to click on it. Then into the detailed form, all the details with respect to this microwave link, like what is the link type, what is the microwave link name, region and province detail, what are the tower information between which this microwave link is being formed. So all the details of tower at both the end will be visible. Similarly, antenna information will be visible or can be managed onto this. So the system can also create antennas, can also create sectors, and the details of each and every sector can also be seen. If I just click on a sector, then all the detailed attributes with respect to the sector can also be seen. Like these are the GIS information of this sector, what is downlink, what is uplink, port number, azimuth, the references, the installation info, so everything can be mapped. Let me go through the FTTX network. If I talk about an FTTX network, so in the FTTX network, we also have, we do have the POP locations. From the POP location, our splitters, our FDCs are being installed through which the connectivities are being maintained. If I just click on a particular location, like let's say this is one of the my OLT site. If I just hit over it, then you'll get to know that this is my FTTX POP. Like at this location, this is the POP that is associated. This is my FTTX central office. So similarly, in this, the ISP will contain an OLT or VFMS through which the connections are being maintained. If you just look over it, then this is an overhead network that has the poles in between, like all the details of the pole, what sort of pole it is, what are the lat longs of this pole, all the details are automatically there. They are patched in with respect to this GIS system. You can see the details of the cable onto this map only. So if at a location I want to see the details of the splitters, so you can see that there are splitters that are installed. So what are the details of the splitters that you can check from this detail form? Like what is the latitude, longitude, what are the specification of this splitter? So users can choose these specifications, can create their own specifications from the Super Admin portal. They can map the vendor details, they can map the port ratio, the splitter type, and they can choose according to their requirement. You can see over here, there are multiple customers that are being connected. If I want to see that details of the customer. Then I just need to switch on the labels of these customers like this. Then you will get to know the details of the customers as well. Like they even see that there are lots of customers that are mapped. If you want to put up a trace to check the connectivity from source to destination, from OLT to the customer location, or backtrace them, then that also we can do. So if this is an ODF that is installed at a POP location and I want to check the details or the connectivity till every customer that is being mapped, so for that we have the connection pathfinder. The connection pathfinder by which we can enter the equipment ID or cable ID, can select the required port through which we want to put up a trace, and can click on show route. Then it will open up the complete route of that complete network that up to its destination. So in this tabular form, you can see that with respect to source type, source information, source port number, the destination information is being automatically updated. And all the details with respect to the splicing is also being seen. And all the length related information, that what is the network length, what is the length of this complete connectivity, will also be seen. If the user can click on show on map, then he can easily see onto the map that these are the customers that are running or that are being connected with this particular segment. The customer details can also be seen like that. Even we can backtrace any particular customer to check whether it is end-to-end connected with its POP location or not. Here you can see that this is the customer that is being created. If I want to trade this particular customer, I want to check its connectivity, that can also be done. Select this required port, click on show route, and all the connectivity can be shown into the tabular form that will be generated. Like this. If I want to see this complete connectivity onto the map, then you can see that all the details of this POP location can also be seen. This is a FTTH patch panel through which we can check this connectivity. So let me quickly come to a point where if we want to create any network, suppose this is the existing network that is there at this location, and we want to check the feasibility or whether the new customer that comes in into this network, whether it is serviceable or can be feasible from here or not, that we can also check. For that, we have our SQ platform. Let me pick up a lat long to check the feasibility. This is our SQ platform. In this SQ platform, we can enter the location or the potential customer location or address of that location. So it will just land me to that particular area. So this is my potential customer location. If I want to check that within the vicinity of this customer, what is my nearest access point or nearest NAP locator or my splitter, so that I can check. I can just configure this buffer size to check the distance and can hit on the tools. Like if I want to check the nearest primary splitter or secondary splitter, I can choose it. Then on the list in the ascending order of the connectivity, I can able to see that these are two primary splitter, one secondary splitter that lie near to this customer. If I want to check the status of their utilization level, then I can see that there are total number of ports 8, the 4 are utilized and 50% is the utilization. Similarly, if for the next 5 ports are utilized and 62% is the utilization level. I can just hit on any splitter to see what is the shortest route of connectivity. You can see onto the map that this route distance is around 400 meters. So this is the connectivity, and at this location, my S2 is being installed. So this will really help me in calculating the BOM and BUQ to make a new customer serviceable, then how much I need to plan as a new to make them feasible or serviceable. If I want to see the details of this location, then I can see. If I want to see the details of this particular location and address, that is also available. So this is how I can easily make an estimate that this, that's how we can do this. Now, if I just search that particular location or the lat longs onto this inventory platform, then I can also get to know that this is the location for which I have searched for that particular customer. And the nearest splitter that I saw onto the service SQ platform is that this is the splitter that is the nearest to this. So from here, I can plan the network. like I can just roll out the cables like this onto the map, and I can create the connectivity. So once the cables will be there, or the network will be in place, so that this is the cable that is being created, so we can just check that what would be the BOM and BUQ of this network. Like if I want to know that to make this new connection or to check the BOM BUQ of existing connectivity, so how this BOM BUQ can be fetched out. For this, we have the BOM BUQ option. We can just select a particular area for which we want to check BOM and BUQ like this, and whatsoever entities will fall under this selection will be there onto this board. You can see that there are lots of entities that are there. Like we have splitters, we have ONTs, cables, under the selection poles are there. So the cost can be shown. We can select on what network status we want to check the BOM BUQ, and we can just directly hit on it and click on generate BOM. Then a PDF file or Excel file can also be downloaded like this. Similarly, BUQs can be downloaded in this manner. So these informations can be exported into the Excel format as well. So that here close this BOM and BUQ part or the network planning. That's how we see that how we can plan the network or how we can check the BOM and BUQ of the network. Let me come to the work order state where suppose there is a work order that needs to be generated for the field teams so that they can plan the network or they can convert the existing network to the as-built state once the construction work got completed. For that, we have the network tickets. By using the network ticket module, what we can do is that we can assign a particular area to the field engineer. Suppose this is the area that I want to assign to a particular field engineer. I can reshape that particular area, or I can, whatever activity I want to do, I can do so. And I can click on top to it. Then it will open up a network ticket form where I can choose that what sort of ticket I want to generate. What is the ticket reference type? Who is generating the ticket? Let's say I'm generating the ticket. Whom I want to assign? Actually, all the hierarchy, all the field engineers will be, the list of all the field engineers will be available onto this. I just need to choose whom I want to assign this ticket or the work order, to select what sort of network access I want to give, and I can raise the work order. Once this work order is being raised from the mobile application, then this will be available into this dashboard where you can see on the top that this is the work order that has been generated and it is in assigned stage. So like this, all the details of this assigned stage work order can be seen. Now the same work order has been gone to the field engineers where they can use their mobile phones to see what is the work order that they have got. So let me just open up the mobile screen so that you can easily see that what are the things that can be shown onto the mobile app. I hope you can see my mobile screen.
Yes, Harshit.
So this is awesome. This is the mobile screen. I am just logging the mobile app. So this is the Network Access Smart Inventory mobile application. So this will be hand ready with the field engineers where they can type in the application username and password. They can enter their credential and log into their mobile application. So here into this mobile application, there are various modules, the customer management module, network manager module, network ticket module. So basically these modules are coupled up with their independent workflows. We have raised a network ticket. So I'll just hit on to the network tickets here onto the top. You can easily see that there's a ticket that is requested by me, Arshit, on 19th August, and that is in planning phase. If the field engineer just hit on to this ticket, so he will end up onto this location. So here on the map, you can see that this is the area that has been assigned to him. So again, the mobile application comes up with a pre-integrated Google map where you can easily see the information of the location or places. You can change the map views with respect to the use case. Like if you want to turn on the satellite view, so you can see the satellite view as well, or hybrid view, so those views can be configured like this. If the user want to see the network that is there at this current location, so like the web application, the mobile application do also have the layer manager. where the list of the entities that we want to see can be seen onto the map. And the user can easily see the network that is there into this nearby location. You can see like this, that at this location, let me switch off this layers. At this location, the cables are there, all the rest of the entities are there. If the user wants to see the information of any particular cable, then he can hit on the eye icon where he can get the information of any entity, where he can see that there is a cable that is running over it. The cable ID is cable 315. Here he can see that all the distance, all the information with respect to this cable is being shown, like what is the cable ID, what is the type of the cable, what is the name, how many cores does this cable is being running, who has created this cable. So all the attributes that are required to be managed with respect to the web application, the same attributes are being shown. So once the construction work got completed over the field engineers can tag this particular cable segment into the as-built stage as well. In the bottom, you can see that there is an option available, convert to as-built. They can just hit on convert to as-built, and then this cable can be updated successfully into the as-built stage. Also, the field engineer can upload any sort of image or document with respect to this cable. They can choose like this. They can take a picture, real-time picture from the field, and they can upload it. Similarly, documents can also be uploaded. So in the similar way, if the field engineer want to create a new network, so they can create a new network as well. They can click on that plus icon that is available onto the right bottom screen. And they can choose what sort of entities they want to create. Suppose they have chosen a pole. So they just need to select the specification of the pole. And then they just need to point or hit towards a location where they want to create any entity like this. At this location, they want to create a pole and click on OK. So once this is, you can see that pole has been created. In the similar way, any other entity like manhole cables or any other entity can be created. Suppose the user want to create a manhole, then he can create a manhole. He can choose the specification of the manholes like this, select the vendor details, and can place a manhole onto the system. If he want to place the manhole onto this map, then like this, the manhole can be plotted. Now, if the user want to submit this particular work order, then on the bottom left, the entity list is being shown, where he can just check that whatsoever cables on which he has worked or cables or poles, you can see that the cable details or civil structure infrastructure details are being shown. So they can be on these entities he has worked, and he can submit his network by entering its any comments that he want to pass on to their planning guys. He can submit this ticket. Once the ticket got submitted, then they can again log into the web application and can see its status. So onto this web application, the status will be updated, and all the entities that will be created by the field engineer will be part of the system. They can easily see those details or these poles. This pole has been created as a new, so that will be there onto this web application. So let me quickly show you that how the users can localize or locate any fault location with respect to the OTDR reading. So suppose from a field engineer, there is a fiber cut that has been identified by the field engineer from a certain distance, from a certain OTDR reading, so they can easily plot so. Because we do have a fiber cut tracing feature with us, where the user just need to enter the site details, like the equipment details, like this is the equipment ID. If I just open up this fiber cut equipment ID, I'll select it, and to a specific port, I am having the OTDR distance, like this connectivity runs to 2345 meters, and suppose I have an OTDR reading at 1000 meters, there is some fault. I can just pass on this 1000 meters, I can apply to it, then I can easily see onto the map that what is my probable fault location. Like from this 1000 meters, the probable fault location is this. So that's how I can easily relate that this is the location and I can raise the ticket for my field engineers for the O&M purpose for this fault location. I can register this fault so that the tickets can be raised. I can provide the necessary information of the fault, like fiber break or the reason of the fault. I can choose the entity, like on this entity, the fault is there. The reasons can be selected. I can choose the dates, like on which date the fault is being raised, and I can save this so that the ticket will be associated, created for this. And with the same, in the similar way, just like the construction team, the ticket will be there for the network ticket module, like where we can have the multiple type of tickets that can be raised, like the planning, survey, or O&M. So for O&M, the similar kind of tickets can be generated and can be attempted by the field engineer. In the similar way, when this ticket will be assigned, so by using the mobile application, the field engineers can go to, can look, open up that ticket onto their mobile phone and can do their operations activity and can update the ticket, just like the planning or construction team do with their task. Now, if I want to know that, suppose there is a fault at a particular location, like at this location, there is a fault and whatsoever services will be affected or customers that are connected with this will be affected by this fault. So the users can just trace the connectivity or can check the impact analysis with respect to that fault. They can choose this particular cable. They can put up a trace. They can choose its connectivity level and can hit on show route. And onto the map, they can easily see that these customers will be going to be affected. What are the equipment details that will going to be at risk when there will be a fault, like all the details of the splitter or what are the details of the customers. So like this, all the informations can be seen and can be fetched out into a report format as well. Like the, we can also export the Excel report having the list of all the customers or the services that are running onto their particular fibers, and we can easily locate that these are the equipments or the customers or the services that will be at risk during the fiber cut or any other future failure. And we can easily circulate this. And in the future as well, we can also integrate with any other system to check transmit the information to the these customers if they are integrated with the CRM system or any other system, so that they, the SMS can also be sent. So by the integration, we can achieve that thing also even. So with this is about the impact analysis thing. If I talk about the reports, so there are various sort of reports that can be generated from the system. We have the export report module where the user can select a particular area for which he wants to see the reports. They can select it and they can see the reports in multiple formats. There are lots of customized reports that can be generated. User can put up their filters with respect to their requirement, like if they want to put up a filter to see the details of the customer or tables or multiple entities. So they can put up the filters like this. They can select the date range, like for which date, last 6 months, last 3 months or 30 days, they want to see this report, or last 1 year, or they can also choose the custom dates from the calendar for which they want to see the progress of a specific user. Like this, they can choose the date range and can export these results. So in here, all the summary of the cables and the customer will be seen into this, and they can see the details of each and every cable that is being created or managed onto this platform during that duration, and the reports can be exported. You can see that all the details of the cables that are managed onto the system is being shown, and they can be exported into the multiple formats like CSV, Excel, KML, Shape, PDF. In any format, these details can be exported out. So basically, these are the high level features of our solution. And I hope that you like this demonstration and will nice to have you onto this webinar. Yeah, Sudeep, over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Harshit. I mean, brilliantly explained. and I hope so we got the actual aspect of how this entire tool works with all the details, and even like the small points that Harshit emphasized on, like showing the fiber cuts on this on the tool, even do the planning and things like that. So a lot of things that we have seen today, and now we are waiting for the questions. If you have, you can type in your questions so that we would be happy to answer one by one. I already have a few couple of questions that has come already over here. I'll take them one by one, but till that, if there are more queries, you can send them. Okay. So I would start with the Q&A session, and the very first queries that have come in. So I'll just check on that. All right. Okay. So the first question that I see is, what are the methods by which you can integrate the system with other systems? So, okay. So over here, as we know that this tool is already API compliant, and we have open options to integrate with different systems. So now these systems can be CRMs, this can be any kind of alarm monitoring system, this can be even your website. And this is the API that we have and the attributes that we look towards. So that can be transferred to us in REST API or even JSON format. And basis that we can send out the results or the attribute or the things that you're looking towards that can be displayed back onto your system. So yes, it is like a to and fro mechanism. This can be automated. Of course, it is an automated mechanism itself using REST APIs. So I hope so that answers this query. The next one is, what are the deployment options supported by network access? Okay, so yeah, I mean, we have this network access that can be deployed for like on-premises as well as cloud. It is not restricted to any kind of cloud. We are open for Google, AWS, Azure. So we are open to integrate with any kind of cloud deployment, as well as on-premises if required. So that is also possible. Hoping that answers. Coming to the next one, that do we have any third-party GIS license dependency for running the network access? So yes, I mean, we require only the Google licenses that are required. And apart from that, there isn't any kind of licenses that is required from the third party. So this is just the Google part of it. Okay. Okay. Does the software supports sending SMS alerts when received from fiber monitoring system? Okay, yeah, so it does support, like only the thing is that we again have to integrate with the SMS servers. And once we have the pre-configured SMSs, like maybe you have some kind of format of SMS, and basis the type of alarm, so we can create that and we can send it out bulk also. Just for example, if there is an outage or a planned outage or an unplanned outage that has happened, and once an alarm comes in, so using these different mechanisms, like to find out that if there is an impact, so what are the customers who are affected? I can get the list of the customers. From that, I can derive the numbers of them. And from the number, basis the alarm that has come, I will have a lookup table. I will see what is the SMS for this particular alarm, and I'll configure that name of the customer, basis the customer ID, and we can send that out SMS in bulk also. So yes, so that's quite possible. Like once there is an alarm received, we can find out the customers and we can send that to in bulk to others. Not only SMS, we can also integrate with the customer mobile app also, in case they have, like suppose there is a mobile app through which they you want to trigger or send this. So we can send this notifications to their pool, and from there the mobile app can pick and send it to the particular customers. WhatsApp also, there is an option for WhatsApp also. Okay, I hope so that answers. Fine. I mean, is there any third party license aside network access license? So yes, as I told, like only the Google licenses is there, which is anyways embedded with the system itself. So there won't be any kind of other than this third party licenses required. All right. Okay. Some more queries that I see, like what is the logic for finding the shortest path? Okay. Fine. So like whenever there are when we are doing any kind of planning activity, and we want to find out the shortest path between point A to point B. So it basically uses the Google APIs at its backdrop, and it finds the shortest path from the host of other paths. Like, it can give you options of path one, path two, path three, which is segregated as per the distance. And from that, a user can select that I want the shortest path, so you can go for path one. And now there is another logic also along with it. Like, suppose there is you are requiring for a particular amount of cores, like you want to join point A to point B, and that route should contain the fiber which is already installed. We need to see whether it is utilized or not utilized. So if it is not utilized, then a part of the normal shortest path, it will choose the path in which your network is there, and basis that only it will route the connectivity. Of course, if there is no fiber in it, then it has an option to show you another route. But if there are cores available, then it will surely take the priority one of your own network and then the outside. Okay, I see one more question. As you show core to core connect in splicing window, how to know which fault core in splicing window? Okay. So over here, the question is, as you show core to core connect in splicing window, how to know which is the fault core in splicing window? Okay, so fine. I mean, suppose we are having the connectivity for core levels particularly, right? And once you come to know that there is a fault in a particular core, I will select that particular core and see that which are the customers behind them. And since I have the core to core connectivity, I can easily pinpoint that these are the set of customers who are affected because of this particular core. And this is how the splicing window also works. Like, when we are doing the splicing, it takes into consideration each and every cores of it, and it has the connectivity between port one to port three. Then from there, it goes to the core of the fiber. From there, it goes to the splice closure. So that helps to find out the pinpoint where the exact problem is. And through that only, we can do the tracing of it.
In addition to that, there are two more ways. Like, suppose if we are integrated with your NMS system, then any active system, OSS system, then we can easily map those faulty ports or faulty core location onto that particular smart inventory application. But apart from this, if we have an input from the NMS in terms of is there any core that got faulty, so we have the mechanism in our solution as well where we can update the core status. We can update the core status like faulty if we have got input from NMS, so that will be shown with the red color legend, so that will be visible to the rest of the users that this core is at risk or got faulty. So that's how we can map it. So those is a status update of each and every core is also available onto this platform.
Right. Thanks, Harshit. Right. Okay. Yeah. So I hope so that answers the query. And now coming up to one more query, that is email notification alert. So yes, of course, again, this would be a same logic used by the SMS itself. Like, we have the emails in place, and we can generate it through the email server. And so we can create the predefined message, and that can be mailed out to a particular customer if we are integrated with the email servers. So that is also possible. We have done such kind of integrations already, and it's already in working. Okay. There is one more query. I mean, I see there are another last 5 minutes remaining. It's already 3:25 now. So yeah. So in the last 5 minutes, I'll take the last the one more query that is remaining. It is like association and termination points. Like, how do we do this? Okay. So fine. Whenever there is even if we are creating a particular cable, so it always asks for an endpoint. So suppose that there is an endpoint, like there are some predefined logics already in the system that a cable cannot be left hanging all the time. It has to terminate on some or the other passive element or active element or something. So in that case, the tool itself asks that what is the termination element you want to close upon. So for a cable, it will search for a manhole, or it will search for a splice closure, it will search for a chamber. And once you give the selection from that drop down itself, that whatever are the elements where you are terminating, it automatically snaps to it as so that your connectivity is totally exact. And while going for splicing and things like that, you need not search for the cable. You will always see the cable which is very nicely connected to that particular point of the geolocation. So this is how, you know, the association, sorry, the termination points are defined. And now once you are done with this, and if you want to associate the different elements, like, you know, if you want to associate a particular customer to a link, you want to associate a particular element, maybe a cable with a particular trench, a trench with a particular duct. So you have this option of association and disassociation. And once you are done, then it will always keep it into its database. And whenever it feels like, you can fetch it out from there. So this is how the association and termination thing works. All right. So yeah, it's another 3 minutes. We can take up a few last queries in case there are. I hope so. I have answered most of the queries. We'll take a bit of minute and wait for some new queries to come in.
Yeah, I guess there is one more question. In mobile application, can user modify trench and cable geometry? Yes, that is for sure, because from the mobile application can be used for the O&M purpose or for the construction team. So surely they can edit the geometry of the cables, trench, or they can create the new cables or trench. So whatever operation they want to do, they can do it by using the mobile application.
Right. Yeah, fine. So Meenakshi, you would like to take the last few minutes?
Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone. I hope we have answered all your queries. In case we have missed out on anything, we'll get to you on a personal email and we'll answer your queries there. Thank you so much, Sudeep and Harshad, for this insightful session.
Thank you. Thank you, Meenakshi. And thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Have a great day. Bye-bye.